introduce Professor Olga Kharlampovich. She is from City University of New York, and she will deliver a series of 5 lectures here on group actions of arteries and lambda trees.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. I request Professor to please continue. Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. Let me just begin with this theorem, which I don't know. It's like I will prove it to you later. It's attributed to Sir, but like I think it's a folklore which was known before. So you already, Gilles was talking about free groups, right? So group is free if it is basically the set of words in the alphabet of letters and the inverses. And there are no relations between these words. So group is free if and only if it acts freely by automorphisms on a tree. So a tree, it is a graph without, a connected graph without loops, right? So this is what is a tree. And automorphism of a tree, it's bijection which maps vertices to vertices and like corresponding edges into edges. Like if two vertices were connected by an edge, so they must be mapped into vertices also connected by an edge. So free action means that no inversion on edges and stabilizers of vertices are trivial. So again, like in the first lecture today, so you saw the Kelly graph of a free group, which is a tree, right? And free group acts on its Kelly graph, and it acts freely on it. So stabilizers of vertices are trivial. But the converse thing is also true. So if a group acts freely on a tree, then it is a free group. Now, so R trees are mentioned in my basically in my title. So let me just tell you what is R tree, but I'll talk about R trees later in details. So R trees, it is a class of metric spaces. Like the easiest definition is probably that it is a geodesic zero hyperbolic metric space. So again, you've seen already like this Gromov's definition of a hyperbolic metric space. So triangle is supposed to be thin, and delta thin in hyperbolic metric space. In an R3, triangles supposed to be tripods. So they're very, very thin. And one can define this like also the same definition. So it is a geodesic metric space. If two segments intersect in a single point, which is endpoint of both of them, then their union is a segment. And the intersection of two segments with a common endpoint is also a segment. So this is what is an R3. Now, let me give you.
What is the second?
Hmm? No. Like, I mean, if you have two segments with a common endpoint. Yeah. Like, so. So it's a, they have a common endpoint, so the intersection is a segment. And the union of two segments with a common point is also a segment. If they intersect at a single point, then it is also a segment. So some examples of R3s. Like R3s are basically, so where they appear? They appear as like asymptotic cones of hyperbolic spaces. They appear as Brownian like trees in probability theory. They appear as limits of group actions on hyperbolic space. So they appear in many places, there is like theory. Which is maybe due to initially to Ilya Rips of free actions on R3s and like small actions, so which I'm going to talk about, but again like later. So the examples. So if you take a usual real line with usual metric, it is an R3. If we consider geometric realization of a simplicial tree, like So if you have a simplicial tree, like you have vertices and edges, and like the length of each edge, each edge has length 1. Now, but we can consider geometric realization, so when we consider all points as the points of this metric space, right, and then the geodesic between like these two points is going to go like this, and we'll have a corresponding like length. So geometric realization of a simplicial tree. Then one can turn a plane into a real tree the following way. So to go between like the geodesic between one point and the other is the following. You have to go orthogonally to the x-axis, go along the x-axis, and then go to the other point. So that's this way plane turns into an R3. Then like the famous joke of French mathematicians, that the French railway system also forms an R3. Now, how it is? Like in France, to go from point, like, so this is Paris in the middle. If you want to go from point A to point B, so if this point B is on the same railway from Paris, then okay, then you just go like this. If you want to go to point C, you have to go to Paris and go along the rail from Paris to point C. So one can check, like this is exercise, check that this the plane with this metric actually forms an real tree or R3. Okay, now, so R3s are generalization of simplicial trees. Again, for the future things, I need some construction. So I'm going to talk, maybe in the first two lectures, I'm going to talk about the so-called Bastur theory. So Bastur theory, Sir started this theory because, so basically the idea is to connect the algebraic structure of a group, so to understand the algebraic structure of a group acting on a tree. Like, so what can we say about the group if it acts on normal simplicial tree? So he wanted to understand the structure of some algebraic groups. But the theory turned out like to be much more powerful very, very useful. So we want to connect algebraic, we want to understand algebraic structure of the group acting on a tree. But again, like the theory, came as a generalization of the previously known constructions of an amalgamated product of groups and HNN extension of groups. So, like first I'm going to talk about amalgamated product and show how group which is an amalgamated product of two groups, how it acts on a tree, and so how to construct a tree, so how it's all these things related. So, okay, so we have three groups, A, B, and C, and we have injective homomorphisms from C into A and B. Now, if this diagram is a push-out, so, like, what this means? That this means that this is the most general, that this group G is the most general completion, like, of this commutative diagram. So, there are maps from A to G and B from to G, so that if there are some other maps from A to some other group and B to some other group making this diagram commutative, then there is a unique homomorphism from G into other group. This is what means push out. So then this group G is called an amalgamated product of A and B over C. Now, if we, in terms of generators and relations, so how do we construct an amalgamated product? So if group G is given by generators, generating set S1 and relations R1, and B is given by S2 and relations R2, then so we take their free product, so we take disjoint union of the generators, relations of this group, And we write that like the image of element from C in A is equal to the image of element from C in B, like for each element of C. And so like simplest example. So consider orientable surface of genus 2, right? Orientable surface of genus 2 has two generators and this relation, product of two commutators is equal to 1. Right? You can get it like this. You can consider like free group with generators AB, free group with generators CD, and take the amalgamated product along a cyclic subgroup, and like cyclic subgroup generated by one element, and this element, like the map sigma, so maps this generator into a commutator of AB, and map tau maps it to a commutator of CD. Then exactly, so this surface group is an amalgamated product of two free groups. Okay, now we can also talk about like in terms of spaces. So how we get like fundamental group of two spaces like this. So suppose we have two groups. We have group A and B, and we would like to construct a space whose fundamental group is amalgamated product of A and B over C. So what do we do? Like there exists a CW complex, like Eilenberg-MacLane space, which has a fundamental group G. Like this is for any group G. So what you can do? Like you take how you construct it. So you take loops corresponding to generators, and then you glue faces corresponding to relations. So the fundamental group is going to be exactly the fundamental group of is your group G. So take Eilenberg-MacLane space for A, like for B, and for C. Right. So we know that there are this injective maps sigma and tau from C into A and B. So the spaces for A it's going to be X, for B it's going to be Y, and for C it's going to be Z. Then take a cylinder, like take a direct product of Z and unit interval, right? And identify it, like let me just show you the picture here. So basically now you identified like this sides with corresponding boundaries of X and Y. And the fundamental group of this space by Seifert van Kampen theorem is going to be amalgamated product of fundamental group of X, fundamental group of Y, and over the fundamental group of Z. So like what I did for surface is going to be like this. And just as another example, so if we have a connected surface and we have a non-separating simple closed curve, right? Then you always can represent like the surface, the fundamental group of a surface, you can represent it as an amalgamated product of two free groups, which are fundamental groups of, like, so this is a separated closed curve. So you cut a surface into two surfaces with boundary. Each of them has fundamental group, a free group, and then you take the amalgamated product, you got a surface group. Now, if it is non-separating simple closed curve, then you have an HNN extension. So then your injective homomorphism signed to the same group. And we'll see a little bit later the picture for this. Okay, so now let's, what is nice about amalgamated products? Elements in amalgamated products, they have very nice normal forms. Like there is a normal form for every element. So how to construct a normal form? So suppose we have an amalgamated product of A and B over C. Choose a system of right coset representatives. So C it is a subgroup of A, and D it is like the isomorphic subgroup of B. Take a system of right coset representatives. So what is a normal form? Like there is a notion of C normal form and D normal form. So C normal form, so of an element. It is a sequence, x0, x1, xn. So x0 belongs to C, and xi's are these right coset representatives, they alternate right coset representatives of A and B. Right? So in this, and if the first element not in C but in D, then we talk about D normal form. So clearly, like if you have a C normal form, apply this isomorphism phi to x0, and then you get a D normal form. So every element from the so it's no questions, right, about normal form. So first element in C, and then we alternate right coset representatives of C in A and D in B. Okay, so every element can be written uniquely in like C normal form. Let's just prove this. It's an exercise. Oops. Okay. So, first of all, elements A and B generate the group, right? So every element can be written as a product of, as an alternating product of elements from A and B. Now, if this element is in C, okay, then it is in a normal form. Then it is just x0 and the whole string, it is just one element. Now, otherwise, let's use induction. So represent this last element, bk, as a product of element from D and right coset representative, right? Now, element from D, we join together with, so element from D is also equal to some elements in C, which is element from A, right? So we take this product ak by b tilde, okay? And this is element in A. So we have now, this is new element in A and right coset representative of B. And now we apply induction because the sequence became shorter. Oops. Okay, so this is like the existence. So every element can be put into the normal form, uniqueness. Why it is unique? So what we're going to do, we'll make the group, the amalgamated product, we'll make it act on the set of C normal forms. Okay? So first, like how it acts. First, the first group, A, acts on the set of C normal form. It acts sort of in natural way. So if like x0 was in C, if g is in C, okay, then this is just g times x0, so this is the first element in C. If it is not in C, okay, then it is in A, represent this element as a product of right coset representative and element in C, and so we have this. We have the of length 2, string of length 2. Now, and basically, here, okay, let's just consider a couple of cases. Suppose G is in C, then we have this normal form, right? We don't touch x1, xn, but this element is in C also, so we just keep it here. Now, suppose that x1 was in B, and G is not in C. G is not in C. Then again, we multiply G by x0, it's not in C, so we take right coset representative and element in C, and we're getting like a longer form. And for these two cases, the same thing. So, for example, if x1 was in A, then, so x1 was in A, x0 was in C, right? So also in A. We multiply it by G, which is in A. So we got some elements, these three elements, this product is in A. So we have right coset representative and element in C. So the form changes. And this is when this product belongs to C. So then x2 stays here and x1 joins like x0 and they belong to C. So this is an action of A on the set of C normal forms. Now B similarly acts on the set of D normal forms. Now we extend this action. Oops. So there is a, this is a map from C normal forms to the set of D normal forms. What we do, we just have to change like this first element from C to D. B act on a set of C normal forms like this. So first we move it into D normal forms, then use the action of B, and then we move it back. Okay, so then we can extend the action. We have action of A and B on the set of C normal forms. We can extend it to the action of free product. And then the kernel of this action is exactly like this, this relation, that elements from C equals to corresponding elements from D. Okay, now take now element. So we have the action of this group on the set of C normal form of the amalgamated product. Now take element one and act by G. So we have C normal form. So the action takes element to unique element. So therefore it's like C normal form is unique. Okay, so we have this, and this is going to be, we're going to need it. So, definition of the normal form. Okay, so it's here. No, this is already the proof. So normal form is a sequence. So first element belongs to C, it is a C normal form, and then we alternate right coset representatives of C in A and D in B. By the way, like, I mean, I can send you the slides or whatever. They probably can organize this, the organizer, so you can look at it more careful. Okay. So now, the important property of amalgamated product. So if you have an amalgamated product, then there exists a tree on which this amalgamated product, this group G, acts without inversion on edges and such that the factor graph. So what is a factor graph? It is a graph of orbits of vertices, right, and edges. So the factor graph over the action is a segment. Okay, segment is following graph. So this is a segment. This is a segment. So again, if you have an amalgamated product, then this group acts on a tree nicely. The quotient graph is exactly the segment. Moreover, so this segment can be lifted to a segment into, like into this tree, right? With the property that the stabilizers in G of its vertices and edges are equal to G1, G2, and A. So there is a segment in the tree such that stabilizer of this vertex is G1, stabilizer of this vertex is G2, and like the amalgamating subgroup is a stabilizer of the edge, like intersection of stabilizer of the vertices. Okay, so let's prove this. Such this usually does not go very easily, so it's a little bit technical, but this is why I want amalgamated product, not like general case. So what are the vertices of this tree? So we have an amalgamated product. What are the vertices? The vertices are left cosets of one group and the other group. So the vertices are union of left cosets of the groups. And the edges are, so vertices I have, I write this as a graph X, so zero cells, vertices. One cell, so edges are left cosets of this group A, right? Now, and so how we put, so if you have the edge GA, so edge is left coset, then the initial vertex of this edge is going to be the coset of G1, and the terminal vertex, it is a coset of G2 with the same element, with the same coset representative, okay? So, and now T tilde, it will be the segment with this like vertices are left coset, right? So there is a left coset corresponding to identity element for G1, and there is a left coset corresponding to identity element for G2. So this is a like lift of my segment. They are stabilizers, right? Because like the now the group acts on this tree as left multiplication. So then who is the stabilizer of the vertex corresponding to G1? G1, right? So if you multiply it by element of G1, we stay here. If you multiply it by something else, we have some other coset. So stabilizers of these vertices G1 and G2, and stabilizers of the H is the intersection, like the associated amalgamated subgroup. Okay, now let's show the following thing. So we form the graph. Vertices are left cosets of G1 and G2, and edges are left cosets of the amalgamated subgroup. So why this graph is a tree? Like why it is a tree? First, we show that it is connected. So where it is connected? Again, like what we have to show? We want to show that it's like, okay, so what we want to show? Like first of all, the vertices alternate, right? We have coset of G1, coset of G2, coset of G1, coset of G2. So we want to show, let's take a coset of G1. And show that it is connected by a path to G1. Okay, so like this coset, like take element G, right? It is an alternating product of elements from G1 and G2. So this is like there are two possibilities. So this is G1. So what we want to show? We want to show that it is connected to G1 vertex, to this one. Okay. If GI belongs to G1, then this is the same coset as this one, right? And we can apply induction on the length of the element. If GI belongs to G2, then this coset is connected to this coset by an H, right? This is how we constructed the graph. The H going to be this element times A, right? So then this vertex is connected to this vertex, and here again we can make shorter like this representative because GI belongs to G2. So now we can connectivity shows follows by induction. Like every two cosets are connected. So they all connected, they all go to G1, they all connected by a path to G1, and therefore this is a connected graph. Now we have to show that it is a tree. And for this, I proved this result about normal forms, that the normal form is unique. It doesn't like me, this computer. I'm afraid to touch it because now it's working somehow. Otherwise, it may stop. Okay, so suppose we have a loop, right? So suppose we have a loop, E1, EN. So there are some edges which form a loop. Okay, so suppose without loss of generality, we can assume that we started like at G1 because everything is like moved. Every picture is moved by left multiplication to some other place, right? So we can move, like, we can begin in G1. And then what happens? Like, we went, we multiply by alternating, like, elements from G1 and G2. And we came back to G1. So this contradicts to the, this means that we got the same coset, right? But so G1 multiplied by this alternating product is again G1. But this contradicts to the uniqueness of the normal form, of this C normal form. So this cannot happen, and we got a tree. Okay, so what we got? If you have an amalgamated product, then amalgamated product acts on a tree. And stabilizers, so there are in this tree, there are two vertices such that stabilizers of these vertices are exactly our groups G1 and G2, and the stabilizer of the H between them is exactly like amalgamated subgroup. Okay, now let's just do some remarks. So first of all, like if we have the, suppose we have the initial vertex, so how do we construct this tree? Suppose we have the vertex like G1, like who are the edges? So the edges correspond it goes to two. Oops. And so the edges correspond to left coset representatives of A in G1, like G2A, G3A. Like, so these are left cosets of A in G1. And therefore, the valency of this vertex is going to be like the index of A in G1. Now, so what is the stabilizer of this vertex? The stabilizer of this vertex is a conjugate of the stabilizer of G1. Okay, so now the inverse statement also true. So suppose we have, suppose the group acts without inversions and edges on the tree, and suppose that the factor graph is a segment. Again, we have a group action, biotomorphisms on the tree, the factor graph is a segment, and we can locate, take arbitrary lift of this segment, denote the vertices, just take them P and Q now. Take their stabilizers like GP and GQ. Then the stabilizer of the H is going to be, of the H between them is going to be intersection of their stabilizers. Then this homomorphism from amalgamated products into G, which is identity on GP and GQ, then it is actually an isomorphism. So what it says, that if the group acts without inversions and edges on the tree, and if the quotient graph is a segment, then the group is an amalgamated product of stabilizers. Like take arbitrary segment in this tree, take any segment in this tree, take stabilizers of the vertices, then our group is isomorphic to the amalgamated product of vertex stabilizers over the edge stabilizer. So this is like if and only if, like the group is an amalgamated product that acts on a tree. If the group acts on a tree and the quotient graph is a segment, then the group is an amalgamated product. Now I don't think like you want the proof of this, right? I wrote the proof of this, but you can do it as an exercise, probably. Like the idea is that you have to, basically, first you have to show that they actually generate, the stabilizers generate the group, right? And if not, then you can show that it is not a connected graph. So they must generate the group. And then second, I don't know. Do we want to go through this proof or not? Or do we want to go further? How many different presentations is an amalgamated product? I mean, sometimes, yes. Sometimes you can, like, you know, there is this, like, JJ decomposition, different, like, things. So, yeah. You take, like, JJ decomposition, right, and then you start, like, collapsing different edges. So, you know, I think I'll skip this proof. Let's better talk about SL2Z. Like, it's a good example. It's actually the example, like, canonical example in Searle's book, Trees of 1977. So we want to show that basic, what we want to show later, like let me just show. We want to show that SL2Z is actually an amalgamated product of Z4, like cyclic group of order 4, cyclic group of order 6, over cyclic group of order 2. And cyclic group of order 4 is generated by this matrix, cyclic group of order 6 is generated by this matrix, and cyclic group of order 2 is like this matrix. Now, how does Searle prove this? So SL2Z acts on the hyperbolic plane. So here we represent hyperbolic plane as a half plane, and hyperbolic line is an open half circle, or open half line, which is such that the closure means the real axis at right angles. So like, hyperbolic lines like this or like this. This is the x-axis. Okay, so Möbius transformation of hyperbolic plane is this map, right? And then SL2R acts on the hyperbolic plane by Möbius transformation. So the matrix A, B, C, D acts exactly like this. The kernel of the section is plus minus one, so it's the center of the group. Now, so this this is a fundamental domain for the action of PSL2Z, and basically, so if you take this arc, if you take the arc represented by E I alpha, so when alpha is between pi over 2 and pi over 3, then like one can show, like you can do it as an exercise, that the images of this arc under the action of the group SL2Z form a tree. Like so they fill in, they form a tree. And SL2Z acts on this tree without inversion of edges, and so distinct points of the arc are not equivalent. And then stabilizers of the endpoints, okay, this you can really compute as an exercise, like take this element, so e to the pi over 3 alpha, right, and compute the stabilizer, like prove that this matrix generates a stabilizer. So this gives the decomposition of SL2Z as an amalgamated product of like two finite cyclic groups over Z2. By the way, this also shows that like if the group has such a decomposition, then the group is so-called virtually free. Virtually free means that it has a finite index free subgroup. So there is a subgroup of finite index, which is a free group. Now, basically SL2Z, it's almost a free group. It has a free group as a subgroup of index 12. And so this also follows, like for example, from this decomposition. Similarly, you can like decompose GL2Z, right? So it is a amalgamated product of two dihedral groups, D4 and D6 over D2. Now these are matrices which generate D2. Now, Searle also proves in the same book that for n greater or equal than 3, SLNZ and GLNZ cannot be represented as non-trivial amalgamated products, and therefore, so they do not act on a tree. Okay, so that's a nice example of amalgamated product. Now, let's talk about HNN extensions. So, what is HNN extension? Like, again, this, please, like, I mean, like if you have a surface, a non-separated simple closed curve, then it is an HNN extension of a free group. So HNN extensions, we have group H, we have like a subgroup A, And we have an isomorphic image of AB, which is also a subgroup of H. So we have two isomorphic subgroups, A and B. Then we form this group. So we make this A and B conjugated. So we add new element T and conjugate like every element of A into corresponding element of B by T. So we add this family of relations. Two relations of H, we add this family of relations. Okay, HNN extensions are very similar to amalgamated products. So they also, there are normal forms in there. So normal form is now this string. So basically what we do, we begin with an element in H, then we alternate letter T with right coset representatives of A and B. And the same proof like shows that the normal form is unique for HNN extension. So every element has a unique representation like this. I mean, this is a very convenient thing because basically HNN extensions, I think they are, so HNN, Higman, Neumann, Neumann. And they appeared when, for example, in the Boone's construction of the group with undecidable word problem. Like you, when you want to like interpret Turing machine, it's very easy to interpret in a semigroup. And it's very hard to interpret it as in like Turing machine with undecidable halting problem. Very hard to interpret it in the group. So you really have to like have control of what's happening with elements because like if the machine stops, okay, so you follow the relations. But how to prove that if the machine does not stop, then something is not spoiled. And HNN extensions were used exactly for this. Like this was like Britton's lemma showing that every element has a unique representation. For example, if you have a representation of the element like this, right, this element cannot be equal to one. Because if the element is equal to one, okay, then it is just like G0. Cannot have any letters T. So if you have letters T and elements like different representatives of right cosets of A and B in between of them, this element cannot be equal to one. Now HNN extension. If the group is an HNN extension, then there exists a tree. So HNN extensions also act nicely on trees. There exists a tree on which a group acts without inversion on edges, but the factor graph is a loop. So the factor graph is like this. It is one vertex and a loop. So it's not a segment, it isn't for amalgamated product. It is a loop. And like this is a, I just give you an example. So let's take a group, some group L, and take the subgroup C and this isomorphic image also C. So basically what we're doing, this is what's called extension of centralizer. We just add letter T and say that this letter T conjugates every element of C into itself. So T commutes with all elements of C. Like this way we extend the centralizer of C in the group of L, like in a free way, we just add one more letter to the centralizer. So then what this is a, like this is what you're getting. So L is here. So L is connected to vertex with representative like TL. Now vertices of this tree are also left cosets of the group which we extend in G, right? And edges correspond to left cosets of the associated subgroup of C. The construction is, so the tree looks like this. So you see L, and then edges corresponding to different cosets of C in L. To this, like this is a vertex TL, this is like G1TL, this is like GNTL, and so on. So we have a, if C has infinite index in L, we have infinite valency tree, but we have a tree. Okay. so yeah, basically, again, what we have to show, so vertices are left cosets of it was L on the picture, but H in the theorem. Edges are left cosets of A. And we define, now how we define the map. Initial vertex of the edge, GA, it is GH. But the terminal vertex of GA, it is GTH. And then if you take the segment in H with vertices H and TH, then G acts on like, so G acts on this 3 by left multiplication. And again, it is like the uniqueness of the normal form implies that this is a 3. Also, like the converse is true, so if the group acts without inversion on edges on a tree, and suppose that the factor graph is a loop, take now arbitrary segment in H, yeah, in X, this is like interesting. So this is like in the tree, it lifts, it, like this lifts as a segment. And let's call this H, let's use the orientation. So then if you take a lift, okay, so then this vertex lifts, but this, so the lift looks like this, the vertex and one like oriented edge, right? And okay, now we take, so this is called P, this is GP, the stabilizer of vertex P. And so basically, we go in like we're getting that the group like so the group acts on a tree. Factor group is a loop. Take arbitrary vertex like oriented H, and then we have an H in an extension of the stabilizer. Of the stabilizer of this vertex by letter T over the stabilizer of the like, of the stabilizer of the H. Now it starts. okay, so this is for H and N extensions. I think I skip like the proof. Now let me just give a definition like at the end of so what is the so-called graph of groups? But let's, so we were talking about graphs of two types, a segment and a loop. Now, what is the general case? So first of all, a directed graph consists, okay, we have vertices, we have edges, and we have, each edge has beginning and end, right? And actually, like the inverse edge just goes the opposite way. So the beginning of HE, it is the end of HE inverse, and the end of HE is the beginning of E inverse. So this is, we have origin and terminus of H. So okay, non-oriented graph, so it's a directed graph like with involutions, so which satisfies the following conditions. So this is what I said, that the double inverse is the same edge, and initial vertex of the inverse is terminal vertex of HE and the other way. So we just, like, when sometimes we talk about oriented edges, sometimes about non-oriented edges. So non-oriented edge, it is just a pair of oriented edges. But when I'm talking about loops, I mean like loops of non-oriented edges. Okay, so now what is a path? Path is a sequence of edges such that terminal vertex of EI is an initial vertex of EI plus one. Now path is reduced if EI plus one is not the inverse of EI, so we don't go like this way and then back. So it is a reduced path. Path is close to a loop if it is a loop, if coming back, so there's a loop. Now, what is the morphism of graphs? So vertices go to vertices, edges go to edges, like morphism, like image of sigma E is sigma of the image of E, and the same thing for tau. So the graph is a subgraph if vertices are vertices of the graph X are subvertices of the graph Y, and the edges are like edges of X belong to edges of Y, and inclusion maps form a morphism. So it's kind of natural, like it's okay. What is graph of groups? So graph of groups consists of a connected graph. So a function function should be different letter, which for every vertex we, so for every vertex we have a vertex group, for every edge we have an edge group, and there is a monomorphism, so a vertex group into like corresponding edge groups. Basically, we already have seen graph of groups. Like this is a for amalgamated product. So if you amalgamate A and B over C, so then the corresponding graph of groups is a sigma. So we have group which corresponds to this vertex is A, group which corresponds to this vertex is B, and the group which corresponds to the edge is C. And there are like monomorphism from C into A and B. Now the graph of groups which correspond to H in an extension, it is a loop with a single vertex. So then your H is here, and then so it's an H in a H and an extension of H over like so T inverse C T equals phi of C. Okay, so then so this is what is graph of groups. Maybe I have to stop. Like I would like to define a fundamental group of graph of groups, which I like start tomorrow. But fundamental group of graph of groups, which is a segment, it is an amalgamated product. And fundamental group of a loop, with like group and assigned to vertex and edge, it is an H and an extension. So fundamental group of a graph of groups, it's going to be generalization of both of them. And in addition, it's going to be a fundamental group of the corresponding space, like in the normal notion, like it's really going to be a fundamental group. And like what we're going to do next time, so I'll show that if the group acts on a tree without inversions on edges, then it is a fundamental group of a quotient graph of groups. And if it is a fundamental group of a graph of groups, then it acts on a tree. So that's basically essence of Bassur theory, which has nice applications. Okay, thank you.